Hello and welcome to the Ask VR on Aaranya Kaandam. Before we begin this episode, a reminder that this film script is available on the Film Companion website. Here's the link. Dina Boy asks, what makes this film so special being a neo-noir film? Before getting to neo-noir, let's see what noir is. Noir in French means black. So noir cinema refers to a set of black and white films made in the 1940s and the 1950s. I'm generalizing a bit, but the dark shadows of the cinematographies hinted at the dark and pessimistic and cynical world that these films were set in. So what is neo-noir? Neo means new, so neo-noir is just a newer generation of noir. It refers to the films made in the genre from the 1960s onwards. Again, I'm generalizing a bit, but we're talking about color cinematography, more violence, harsher themes, more nudity, and also references and callbacks to the original noir cinema. So why is Aaranya Kaandam a neo-noir or a new noir kind of film? Because it uses a lot of the things that we associate with the genre. Number one, the femme fatale, that is the woman who traps an unsuspecting man into executing her schemes. Number two, the voiceover. Three, a fairly complex plot. Four, a lot of gangsters with no cops in sight. And even when we see these cops, they are not authoritarian figures, but more like foolish people that we laugh at. Lots of shadowy lighting. Some monochrome lighting, tilted camera angles or Dutch angles, the grey morality, there are no real good guys, even the so-called good guys end up doing bad, unlawful things. And finally, a world that allows bad guys to go get away unpunished. It is not a moral world. So I'm sorry if that sounded like a bit of a history lesson, but that is why Aaranya Kaandam is special. It's the first neo-noir film in Tamil. I might even say it's the only neo-noir film because a few years later we got Onayum Attukuttiyum, which is like kind of the same kind of film, but it's a far more compassionate film. Anyway, let's not go down this track because then we will be talking about what is noir and neo-noir forever. Let's get to the next question. Sujit Kumar asks, are there any similarities with the storyline and the Ramayana? Or is the title just a nice way of saying that the city is the jungle? I don't know if there are actual similarities with the Ramayana, though you could say the way the Sampath character, Pasupati's wife, is kidnapped is a bit like Sita being kidnapped. Plus her name is Kasturi, which is the name of a deer, and the kidnapping of Sita did involve a deer in the epic. But I think this is more about the meaning of Aaranya Kaandam. Aaranya means forest and Kaandam means chapter. So this is a story about people who live like animals and who live by the laws of the jungle.
Subbu, puluva meen thinno, meena manchandamma, life na appudan.
The names of the characters, they are from the animal kingdom too, starting with Singaparamal. He looks like a lion baring his teeth, though Thiagarajan Kumararaja said this is the face he usually makes to his mother. Look at the names of the other characters too. Pasupati, Kalayan, Chittu, Gajapati and Gajendran. Look at how Sampath's voiceover describes Gajendran.
Gajendran ku madam pidichiruchna thumsam panniruva.
Madam Pidikirthu is usually a phrase we use with the elephant, and in this scene, Gajendran really looks like a mad bull elephant charging. So I think that is what this is about rather than the Ramayana itself. Ganapati Yogesh asks a question about the background score of this film. He says, what do you think made Yuvan place like more melodic kind of music in the final gangster face-off? Okay, I don't personally know why Yuvan did this, but it's beautiful, so let's listen to it a bit. I look at it as something that goes with the existential mood of the film. See, this is not a typical action movie where you need an adrenaline pumping score. The action has come about after a lot of deliberation by Sampath. So the key emotion here is not the action itself, but whether Sampath will be able to pull off his dangerous plan. And this music, at least to me, this music reflects that. Similarly, this waltz is wonderful. It has a bit of sadness, but the basic beat of the waltz, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, it prevents it from getting too sad. Again, it's hard to define, but to my mind, it's something existential. The music does not hype up the emotions, like look at this music towards the end. The woman has succeeded, right? So you might expect some triumphant music, but this again goes with the mood of the film. A bit of trivia. Aaranya Kaandam was supposed to come with three songs. The first one was supposed to be around the heroine playing a video game. Then a song was supposed to happen when the father and son stumble upon the heroine stash and realize that they're going to become rich. This tune was later used in KD Billa Killadi Ranga. And the third song was meant to happen when the Sampath character begins to run. He runs as fast as he can, but the world is slow. The song, therefore, was supposed to play out in slow motion. Relax, Macha. But I think this film plays very well without the song. So let's get to a question by Gomati Mira, who asked, the film displays a serious and tricky conversation between Vishnu Gupta and Chanakya. Is it related to the plot line of the film? So the film opens with this dialogue set in 400 BC, where this character called Naganandan says, Vishnu Gupta yedi dharmam, and Vishnu Gupta Chanakya says, yedi teveyo aduve dharmam. So literally, what does this mean? Naganandan is saying, what is right? Right? And Chanakya is saying, what you need, that defines what's right. But why is this quote in the film? I asked Thiagarajan Kumararaja this, and he said he took this quote from one of his favorite books, the Tamil translation of From Volga to Ganga, which is called Volga Velirindu Gangai Varai. It is a set of short stories that mix fact and fiction to describe the migration of Aryan tribes from Eastern Europe to India. Kumararaja said, it's one of the most eye-opening lines I've read. It solves many riddles about human behavior. So if you apply this quote to this film, each person does what he thinks he or she thinks is right, and that comes from their needs. Only the good guys get a bit of justification.
நம்ம கஷ்டப்படுறது பொறுக்க முடியாம யாரோட முளையோ பூந்து வந்துச்சு பொருளை கொடுத்துச்சு இன்ன இதுன்னு சொல்லுச்சு போயிடுச்சு.
For everyone else, no motivation or justification or explanation is needed to define or explain these characters. They are just defined by this one thing, yedu theveyo aduve dharmo. Kirtika Tangavelu asks, have always wondered why Subbu shot Sappa in the end and not Pasupati. Did she think of Pasupati as an ally? I think one reason may just be that there were no more bullets, right? Because there is a shot where she looks at her gun and then begins to pretend to cry in front of Pasupati. So maybe she realized at that point that there are no more bullets. But then I thought I heard only 5 bullets being shot. Four aimed at Sappa and one aimed at a henchman. If this is the case, then why does she not want to shoot Pasupati? Because I think now that Singham Perumal is dead, shooting Pasupati, who is now the Don, would be too much of a risk. She quickly realizes that, and it's probably easier for her to pretend to be a helpless woman and slip away. Aditya Ramesh asks, what, in your opinion, is the worst thing about this masterpiece of a movie? I don't know, I really love this film, and I saw it again for this program. I just saw it again after almost 7 years, and it still stands, you know, it still stands very well. I don't hate anything as such, but the video game aspect... I found it a bit gimmicky, especially when Subbu says,
"In the game la vara mari, namma vera ulagathukku poitha supera irukum la."
The line sounded too melodramatic and fake, but then again, you could make the case that the line is intended to influence Sappa and therefore it is meant to be corny. It's deliberately corny. So no, I guess I don't have any major problems with the film. Ranjit Kumar asks, why is the character of the small boy so important in the film? Because the small boy and Sampath, Pasupati, are the only two characters who are really good in a way. They are kind of mirrors. Both may be doing bad things, but they are also the only two characters whose tevai need is based on love. The boy's love for his father and Sampath's love for his wife. This line kills me every single time. I mean, it may not even be love, more like a kind of loyalty, you know, sticking through thick and thin. And the shot with Sampath and the boy is probably my favorite in the film. It's an extreme long shot, so you can really see into the distance. Sampath and the boy are very close to the screen, and at that point, Both of them have lost something very close to them. The boy has lost his father and Sampath has lost his wife. And the huge empty space really amplifies their loneliness, their emptiness. They are dwarfed by the surroundings, the circumstances. Aditya Stanley asks, who do you think is the central character of the film? Is it Pasupati, Subbu, Kalyan or the kid? That depends on how you define central character. For this is the kind of film where all the six characters have meaty roles. Subbu, Sappa, Singham Perumal, Kalyan, Pasupati and Kodukapuli, the little boy. But among these, the closest we get to a central character, if you want to define him as a sort of protagonist, is Pasupati. Because he is the only guy who gets an actual hero kind of arc where he has to battle a lot of bad guys and he has a mission to rescue his wife. He's also the film's only straight guy. Almost everyone else is colored with very quirky shades and lines. Even Subbu, for lack of a better word, varinjifies in front of Sappa. So we need one straight guy to anchor everything, and that's Sampath, that is the Pasupati character. Pranav Radhi asks, are most of us too early to celebrate and judge Thiagarajan's craft and style because he's made just one film? I think it's perfectly okay to celebrate a filmmaker even if he's made only one really good film, because we're not saying he's the greatest filmmaker of all time. We're just saying he made one very good film and we can't wait to see what comes next. And I think there is enough in Aaranya Kaandam to establish that there is a very genuine and unique voice and vision. Look at the scene which uses Ilayaraja's song from Thangamagan, Vava Pakkamba. The director once said, if I had to name someone who is responsible for me coming to films, it's Ilayaraja's music. But is the song used only because of Ilayaraja or also because it is from a Rajinikanth film? Because at the beginning, we get this apparently innocent line about pop culture. And this actually becomes a defining character for Subbu later. We think she is an appavi victim. But she turns out to be something else. So coming back to the Ilayaraja song, it could also be this Rajini connection. Because it plays just before the scene where Subbu transforms from appavi to whatever she is, just like Basha transforms from an innocent guy to the Don. Now, I don't know if Thiagarajan Kumararaja really intended it this way or not, but this is one way you can sense that you're in the presence of a good writer-director, because you can keep digging out things like this. Plus, the writing is fantastic. There are no love scenes, no sentimental scenes. There are no hero or villain introduction scenes. I mean, we do get a villain introduction scene, but it's used to show that this man is impotent, and that's so unusual. We'll talk more about writing in this next question by Aditya Uti, who says, the scene with the fortune teller is one of the most revealing scenes in the dynamics of in human interactions. Could you discuss why it is effective even if it is so short? So this is again the kind of offbeat touch that really elevates a screenplay. Instead of having all the characters directly related to the movie, somebody tangential comes into the movie, who's not even a part of the movie in the major sense, and then gives some color to the screenplay and then vanishes. So this fortune teller is definitely one of those characters. In the sense that when we are on the roads, we come across all kinds of people and this guy is one of them. So this is a scene with Gajapati, a dreaded gangster, and it is a great way to introduce not just color and humor, but also some tension. Because you wonder if this annoying, irritating fortune teller is going to escape with his life. And this is when you know the writing is consistent, because it is very similar to another earlier scene of tension and release when Ravi Krishna has just made love to Subbu and the doorbell rings and he panics and he's terrified and he thinks he's going to die. And after a lot of build up, we realize it's just the water can guy. At these points, the screenplay toys with our expectations. Plus, another thing this fortune teller scene has that's consistent with the earlier scenes is the pop culture reference.
Swami, appa neenga manasula nenachikittu irundha andha rendu poo
Prabhu Gospu.
As I said earlier, there's really a voice and vision behind this film. It binds everything together. So those are the 10 questions we picked for Aaranya Kaandam, and I'll end the episode on a tangential note. One of the things about analyzing films and crafts is how you notice that a scene or a shot reminds you of a much earlier film. In Jigar Tanda, for instance, the shot of Assault Sethu entering the theatre without the audience knowing that he's there is filmed in a very similar way to the way in Pyasa, Gurudat's character enters a theater without the audience knowing he's there. It's a very similar kind of lighting as well, with a heavy backlight and all that. Likewise in Aaranya Kaandam, this framing of Subbu and Sappai inside a TV screen is reminiscent of the 1955 Douglas Sirk movie called All That Heaven Allows. It's a scene where a widow's sons gift her a television set so that she doesn't have to step outside for entertainment, and it basically they're treating her like a prisoner because they don't want her to leave the house. The framing shows that because her face is kind of imprisoned in the TV screen. These small discoveries, these little things, these happy accidents, that's what makes film watching so much fun. We'll let you know soon what film we're going to talk about in the Ask VR next. And if you have any suggestions, do let us know in the comments below. Thanks for watching, and do subscribe to Film Companion South.